Hi, good morning everybody. This is second lecture of the series on limb infib. This will also be concluding lecture. Okay, two results we want to prove today. One is, remember we had proved if xn is convergent, then xn limb sup and limb in equal to limit of xn, and conversely if xn is bounded and if limb sup equal to limb inf, then xn is convergent and the limit is common number limb sup and limb inf. Right? Okay, so we would like to prove those things, and second thing is we would like to prove every Cauchy sequence of real numbers is convergent. Okay, this is the aim of this lecture today, so let us get started. Okay, so xn is a bounded sequence as we did earlier of real numbers. Okay, we are defined by limb sup on limb in. I hope you are reviewed before coming to this lecture, so I will not explain that. Okay, so what you have shown last time is if xn is convergent, say xn converges to x, then we proved that the limb sup, limb in equal to limb sup of xn is also equal to x. This is what we proved. Right? Now we may ask the converse. Suppose xn is a bounded sequence in R such that limb sup equal to limb in, can I conclude the sequence is convergent? And if it converges, where do I expect it to converge? It has to converge to the common number, call it x. Is the theorem clear? Okay. Take some time. Okay. Now, the whole thing hinges upon the way we define limb sup and limb inf. And that in turn depends upon a proper understanding of the concept of LUB or supremum of a set of real numbers and infimum or GLB of a non-empty subset of real numbers. So let us first recall that, because that's very important. And most of the problem in analysis for students is not proper understanding of upper bound, lower bound, least upper bound or supremum or infimum or GLB, greatest lower bound. Okay, and the best place to learn those things will be my book on real analysis. Let A be a subset of R, non-empty subset of R. Let alpha be LUB of A. I like least upper bound because it's somewhat easier for me to understand than supremum. Alpha is the least upper bound, meaning it is an upper bound and it's the least among all upper bounds. So the moment you are given alpha as least upper bound in analysis, the first thing it should strike me, the way to exploit this would be, if alpha dash is less than alpha, then it cannot be an upper bound. If it's an upper bound, then alpha must be less than or equal to alpha dash. You understand? Therefore, alpha dash is not an upper bound. If alpha dash is not an upper bound, what does that mean? There is at least one element x in A, so that, what's the relation between x and alpha? Alpha dash. Alpha dash is not an upper bound. Therefore, there is at least one x which is strictly greater than alpha dash. Remember, alpha is an least upper bound, in particular an upper bound for A. Therefore, x will be less than or equal to alpha. Is that clear? Yeah. Now, how do I find such an alpha dash? That's easy. You give me an epsilon positive, right? Then what do I have? Let's look at alpha minus epsilon. That will be strictly less than alpha. In some cases, I would like to generate a sequence by using this fact, alpha is least upper bound. I may want to generate a sequence. In that case, what do you think I will do? I will specialize epsilon. What kind of epsilon I will choose? I will choose epsilon to be 1 upon n. Okay. Now, how am I going to get a sequence? For each n, this is not alpha minus 1 upon n. It's not an upper bound of A. Therefore, I know there exists an x, that x I will call as xn. Therefore, I got a sequence xn. Where does it belong to? This is in A. And with what property? Xn is strictly greater than alpha minus 1 upon n and less than alpha. Do you see something very interesting? By sandwich lemma, this is strict. I am writing less than equal to, but it's strict. Alpha. This is a constant sequence which converges to alpha. This sequence converges to alpha. Therefore, the sandwich sequence converges to alpha. Therefore, if alpha is least upper bound of A, then I know there is a sequence xn in A such that xn converges to alpha. This is an aside. This is not important for our purpose. But this fact is important. The only way to exploit the hypothesis alpha is least upper bound of A is to select a number which is less than alpha. That selection of the number may depend upon the purpose. So what should be the analog of greatest lower bound? Suppose beta is the greatest lower bound. It is the lower bound and greatest among all lower bounds. Therefore, if I choose, I'll just cut it short. So if I choose epsilon positive, let's look at beta plus epsilon. This is greater than beta. Therefore, it cannot be a lower bound for A. If it is not a lower bound for A, what does that mean? It's not a lower bound of A. That means there is an X which is strictly less than beta plus epsilon. Of course, beta will be less than or equal to epsilon because it's a lower bound. Is that clear? The same way I can choose 1 by N also. Please stop, pause, review, and then proceed. If you have not seen carefully the least upper bound and greatest lower bound concepts earlier, this is the best time for you to go back and check this. Then we'll go to the next. Now what I want to do? I want to look at xn is a bounded sequence and this T, the Lim sub of xn is GLB of Tn's. Right? So I want to play with the GLB concept. Since D, T is the GLB, that is the greatest lower bound, if you give me any, so whenever this is given, you should play with the concepts. How do I do that? So epsilon positive be given. Let's look at T plus epsilon. This is strictly greater than T. And T is the greatest lower bound. Therefore, this is not a lower bound. If it is not a lower bound for Tn, what does that mean? This means there exists an element of this set which is strictly less than T plus epsilon. Call it T capital N. Do you understand? Therefore, this is not a lower bound of my An, my Tn's. Therefore, there exists an N so that Tn is strictly less than T plus epsilon. Is this clear? Now, what is Tn? Tn is the least upper bound of what? Xn? Xn plus 1 onwards. This is my An. Right, this therefore the least upper bound itself is less than T plus epsilon. Therefore, what does it say about xk if k is greater than or equal to n? Xk is an element of this. Therefore, for all k greater than or equal to n, sk is less than T plus epsilon. So, what I have shown? I have shown this. If T is the Lim sup of xn, if you give me any epsilon, I can find a natural number n so that for all k greater than or equal to n, xk is less than T plus epsilon. Is this clear? Pause, review, proceed. Now I want to play with the same epsilon. I want to look at T minus epsilon. Remember, T minus epsilon is less than T, but T is a lower bound. It's a greatest lower bound. In particular, it's a lower bound. Right? Therefore, what do I know? For each n, what's the relation between T minus epsilon and Tn? It will be less than epsilon. Right? Do you follow that? Very good. Now, using this fact, what I want to do is I want to construct a subsequence of xn. Xn k. With what property? For each k, this is the aim. Okay, find a subsequence xn k such that for each k, xn k is strictly greater than t minus epsilon. Using this fact. Okay. How do I do that? It's very easy. Let's look at T1. T1 is LUB of A1. That is all terms of the sequence. Right? Now remember, T minus epsilon is less than T1. Therefore, this is already greater than T minus 1. Yeah? So T minus epsilon. Right? For each n, Tn is greater than T minus epsilon. Therefore, T1 is greater than T minus epsilon. That is the least upper bound of this is greater than T minus epsilon. What does it say? This says T minus epsilon is not an upper bound. Do you understand that? Because T minus epsilon is strictly less than T1, which is the least upper bound. Therefore, anything less than that will not be an upper bound for the set. That means there is an element of this set which is strictly greater than T minus epsilon. That means there exists an N1 such that Xn1 is strictly greater than T minus epsilon. Okay. Let me show how to choose N2. Now let's look at the set A. N1 plus 1. This starts from xk where k is greater than n1 plus 1. You understand this? Okay. Now I have the corresponding t n1 plus 1. Remember, for each n, tn is greater than t minus epsilon. Therefore, this fellow who is the LUB of this set. This will also be greater than T minus epsilon. And this is the LUB, and this is strictly less than LUB. Therefore, it is not an upper bound for this set. What does that mean? There is an N2 in this set, A of N1 plus 1, so that Xn2 is greater than T minus epsilon. Have you followed? Notice that N2 must be, or N1 is strictly less than N2, or N2 is greater than, because N2 has to be here. It has to satisfy this condition. Yeah? So let us assume by induction I have chosen X1, Xn1, Xnk, so that for each I, Xni is greater than T minus epsilon, and also N1 less than N2 less than Nk. This is my induction hypothesis. Right now, I have to tell you how to choose xn k plus 1, the next element of this thing. Yeah, what do? I look at the set ank. Plus 1. Notice that I am adding 1 to the index nk. Right? Okay. Now what do I know? T minus epsilon, and I have T nk plus 1. This is the least upper bound for this set. And what we know, this is less than each Tn, therefore this also less than this. What does that mean? T minus epsilon is less than the LUB of the set A n k plus 1. Therefore, this is not an upward one for this set. That means there exists n k plus 1. Remember, this is n suffix k plus 1 in this set, where I will just write it for your sake. So that x of n k plus 1 is strictly greater than t minus epsilon. You follow that? Okay, so I have produced a subsequence x and k, so that for all k, x and k is greater than t minus epsilon. This is 2. Okay, so putting both 1 and 2 together, this is the theorem I have proved. Let xn be a bounded sequence. Okay. Let t equal to lim sup of xn, and let epsilon positive be given. Then I am concluding two results. What are they? One, there is an n, a natural number, so that for all k greater than or equal to n, xk is less than t plus epsilon. And two, there exists an increasing sequence so that for each k, x and k is greater than t minus epsilon. Let us look at the picture. So the first one says there is an n, so that for all k, that is the entire tail, xk should be less than t plus epsilon. The second one, what does it say? I can find infinitely many integers nk, which is strictly increasing, so that x and k will be greater than t minus epsilon. Is that clear? Good. So, review the proof, pause the video, review it, then proceed. So, we have proved a theorem about lim sup playing with epsilon. So, what do you think I should do next? If given a bounded sequence xn and epsilon is given, I should play with lim. What should be the corresponding result? Okay, I will write the corresponding result. Okay, I urge you, after the lecture is over, sit down, review the proof of this first theorem and understand this well, and adapt this, mimic this argument to prove the second theorem which you are going to state. So let S equal to lim inf of the sequence xn, epsilon positive be given. Then what we want to claim is the analog. There is an n natural number, so that for all k greater than or equal to n, my xk will be greater than t minus epsilon. Look at that. Do you see the similarity? So I'm sure that you should be able to say what should be the second one. Look at the second condition. There exists, yes, an increasing sequence of numbers, so that what do you expect? S and k should be less than t plus epsilon. So you see that the roles are reversed for lim inf. I'm sorry. This is what I'm on. It's better to have a classroom, because students, alert students, would have said, sir, you are wanted to talk about this. Because, right? So I have the picture. Yes, S minus epsilon, S plus epsilon. So what does it say? There is an n, so that for all k greater than or equal to n, xk will be greater than this number. So the entire tail will be greater than S minus epsilon. And here, when I come to this side, S plus epsilon, it says infinitely many terms x and k will be less than x n plus epsilon. Okay. As I suggested, after the lecture is over, go through the proof of the first theorem, understand, then try to prove this. You will be very, very confident about infimum, supremum, or GLB, LUB, lim sup lim concepts. Okay. Then you would have mastered it. Okay, let's assume this. Let's go back. What was our original question? Suppose Xn is a bounded sequence so that it's a lim inf equal to lim sup. Does it mean Xn converge to? Yes. Does it converge? And does it converge to the common number S r equal to T? Right? Okay. Is that clear? Okay. Now, what do I have to do? So let us epsilon be given. So I will show that Xn converges to T. Then let me form T minus epsilon, T plus epsilon. Now notice that since epsilon is given and T is the lim sup of Xn, there is an N1 so that for all k greater than or equal to N1, my Xk will be less than T plus epsilon. That's the first condition. And similarly, since T is equal to S, but S is the lim inf of the sequence, there is an N2, so that for all k greater than or equal to N2, what do I know? Xk is greater than S minus epsilon, but S equal to T, therefore it's T minus epsilon. Right? I'm sure now all of you know what to do. Yes? Yes, you're right. Take N equal to maximum of N1 and N2. Then if K is greater than or equal to N, then it's certainly greater than N1 as well as N2. Therefore, my XK will be less than T plus epsilon, but greater than T minus epsilon. That is, my XK will lie in the interval T minus epsilon to T plus epsilon. What does this say? This says XK is convergent, and not only convergent, it is convergent to the T, which is the common lim sup lim inf of the sequence. Okay. So we have proved the converse. So if Xn is a bounded sequence and its lim sup will equal to lim inf, then the sequence is convergent and convergent to the common lim sup lim inf. Okay. So again, pause the video, review it, and then proceed. Now we prove the last result. Okay. With this, our lecture will, this series will also conclude. This up. Okay. Suppose Xn is a Cauchy sequence. I will review it in a minute. We want to say it is bounded. Sorry, we want to prove that it is convergent. This is what is known as Cauchy completeness of R. You given any Cauchy sequence of real numbers, then it is convergent in R. That is, there exists a real number x so that xn converges to x. Okay, let us quickly understand. If xn is a Cauchy sequence, then it is bounded. All of you might have seen a proof, but let me recall. The way you prove its boundedness is similar to the way you proved if xn is convergent, then it is bounded. Here what you do was you looked at you wanted to estimate mod xn. You wrote it as and suppose if I take epsilon equal to 1 and the corresponding n, so that mod xn minus x for all n greater than or equal to n, this is less than 1, therefore it will be 1 by mod x. Then you choose m to be the maximum of mod x1, mod xn, actually 1 plus 1 by mod x. That's how you showed the bound. Now, what to prove x, the same result for Cauchy, we don't have x. But what we will do is, we will replace this x by x capital N. So you take epsilon equal to 1, then there exists n, so that for all n and m greater than or equal to n, mod xn minus xm is less than 1. In particular, mod xn minus x capital N is less than 1. Therefore, if n is greater than or equal to capital N, this is less than or equal to mod xn minus capital xn plus mod xn. Therefore, again choose max m to be maximum of mod x1 mod xn 1 plus mod xn. See, the proofs are exactly similar. It's always a good idea, whenever proofs are similar, try to look at both the proofs simultaneously. On the left side, you write one proof, right side, you write another proof, but try to compare. This way, your understanding will be enhanced, and also it will be easier for you to remember in case you are worried about remembering and writing an exam and scoring high marks. Okay. So what I have shown now? I have shown that if xn is Cauchy, it is bounded. Therefore, let's try to prove a theorem. Xn is a Cauchy sequence in R. I know it is bounded. Therefore, the limb in exists and limbs also exist. I want to show this is Cauchy. This Cauchy sequence is convergent. Okay. Then two things. First, I have to find a likely candidate for the limit. I have to find a real number x so that xn converges to x. Okay. And then I prove xn converges to x. But remember, we will work backwards. What do we know? If xn is convergent, then we know then it converges to the limb sup and limb in of the convergent sequence are equal, and they are equal to the limit of the sequence. Therefore, that gives us an idea to prove xn is convergent, a Cauchy sequence xn is convergent. If I prove s equal to t, then I am through, because limb sup equal to limb in, and therefore I know xn is convergent to the common number s and t. We have seen it earlier, right? So let us try to prove that. Okay. So what do I want to prove? To prove s equal to t. Remember, in analysis, when I want to prove two numbers are equal, usually you try to introduce inequalities. You try to prove for every epsilon positive, you show mod s minus t is less than epsilon. In this case, it's t minus epsilon. In this case, it is t minus s less than epsilon, because t is greater than or equal to s. Okay. Right? Therefore, let epsilon be given. I want to prove mod s minus t or t minus s is less than epsilon. You understand? Now, this is the place why I'm going to play with my two theorems with, okay, where we played with epsilon. Let us look at t plus epsilon. Okay, and t minus epsilon. Okay, right. So let us look at t minus epsilon. Remember, t is also the, sorry, I'm very sorry. Okay, let us look at let me correct my thoughts. Very good. Okay, now xn is Cauchy, right? Okay, let epsilon be given. Since xn is Cauchy, I know there exists a natural number n, so that my, for all k greater than or equal to capital N, my xk lies in the interval xn minus epsilon and xn plus epsilon. Okay, that's the definition. right? Okay. Now, what does it say? Now, let's look at k greater than or equal to n. Let us look at the set AK, which is XK, where K is greater than or equal to N. Now, what do I know? Each XK is less than or equal to, is less than XN plus epsilon. Therefore, what does it say about LUB of AK? Okay. For each K greater than or equal to N, XK is less than this. That means XN plus epsilon is an upper bound for AK. Therefore, the least upper bound, namely TK of AK, that will be less than or equal to XN plus epsilon. Do you accept it? This is an upper bound for AK. This is the least upper bound for AK. Therefore, this must be less than or equal to XN plus epsilon. Sure? Okay. Now, again, concentrate on XN minus epsilon. Each xn is greater than xn minus epsilon. That means, okay, now what is the relation between xk and xn minus epsilon? For each k in ak, xk is greater than that. That means xn minus epsilon is a lower bound for the set ak. But sk is the greatest lower bound for the set. Therefore, what is the relation between sk and xn minus epsilon? This should be. So for all k greater than or equal to n, sk must be greater than xn minus epsilon. So I have xn minus epsilon, xn plus epsilon. This is my sk. It must be greater than, and this is my tk. You understood this? Very good. Yeah. Now specialize t equal to k equal to n. Then what do I have? I have xn minus epsilon, xn plus epsilon. I have sn and tn. Is the picture clear? The same picture here. Now let us look at, so I have the following inequalities. Xn minus epsilon is less than sn. Okay, which is less than Tn, which is less than Xn plus epsilon, right? Now, what is the relation between Sn and S? Remember, Sn is an increasing sequence, it converges to S, therefore S is the least upper bound for Sn, therefore Sn is less than or equal to S. Yeah? Now, what is the relation between S and T? That's less than or equal to T. Now, what is the relation between T and Tn? Remember, Tn is a decreasing sequence and T is the greatest lower bound. Therefore, in particular, it's a lower bound. Therefore, T is less than or equal to Tn plus 1. Go back to the picture. Therefore, I have this. You understood that? Therefore, what do I have now? Xn minus epsilon is less than S. That's less than or equal to T. That is less than Xn plus epsilon. Therefore, T minus S is less than or equal to Xn plus epsilon minus S is greater than this. Therefore, minus S is less than the negative of this. That is minus Xn plus epsilon, which is equal to 2 epsilon. S and T lies in this interval. The total length of this interval is 2 epsilon. Therefore, the distance between S and T should be less than 2 epsilon. That's what we proved analytically. Therefore, what have you shown? For T minus S is less than or equal to 2 epsilon, but epsilon is arbitrary. Therefore, it shows T equal to S. Okay, that means lim sup of the sequence equal to lim inf of the sequence. We have seen earlier in such case, the sequence Xn converges to the common number T. So we have proved Xn, if Xn is a Cauchy sequence of real numbers, it is convergent. Where does it converge to? The lim sup, which is equal, also equal to lim min. Okay. So this all we wanted to say. I hope you enjoyed the lectures. Please go through, as I said, review at least twice. Okay. At each step, stop the video, go through the PDF, understand this, and use a pen and paper if you want. Check it. Then only you proceed to the next point. Don't be in a hurry. Your thing must be to master the subject, not simply understanding the subject. Okay? I hope all of you enjoyed. Please review. Okay? Have a good day.